Hi there. My name is Aaron Landrman. I'm a professor of electrical and computer engineering at Georgia Tech, and this is ECE3084, Signals and Systems.
So the universe is full of a lot of strange stuff. There's neutron stars and pulsars and quasars and all sorts of weird things out there in the universe. And astronomers would like to learn about these various things in the universe. And one way they do that is by studying the radio waves emitted by these various natural phenomena. So what they'll do is they'll stick an antenna and they'll use this antenna to look out into the cosmos and pick up that radiation being transmitted by these various objects. And of course, by transmitted, I don't mean that the objects are intelligent and sending us transmissions on purpose. They just all do their various thing and all of this radiation comes out and we get to pick it up and try to figure out what it means. So these radio waves are part of the electromagnetic spectrum. Let's suppose some of these radio waves that are coming in are centered around 10 gigahertz. Now, I'm going to be writing this axis with the horizontal tick marks in this horizontal axis in terms of hertz. Just be aware if you wanted to represent this in terms of radians per second in omega, you would have to take this f and multiply it by 2 pi. And actually, let me write the gigahertz over here, so I'll just write this as 10. Suppose that the signal runs from 9 to 11 gigahertz. So it sort of has a local bandwidth of 2 gigahertz. That's going to become important in a second. And suppose the signal looked a little something like this. Now, probably these astronomical objects aren't presenting a spectrum whose magnitude looks exactly like a triangle like this. This is just a placeholder. Notice that I'm not drawing something along the lines of one of these kinds of triangles with this conjugate symmetry associated with the double sideband amplitude modulation scheme we looked at in a previous lecture. There's no particular reason to think that the spectrum here is symmetric. And if it was, that would be an amazing sign that there probably is some sort of intelligent life out there trying to send us AM radio signals. Okay, so the raw signals being picked up by the antenna here, those are real valued signals. So there's going to be a conjugate copy down here that's going to be conjugate symmetric, and I'll indicate its conjugateness by shading it in like this, as we traditionally do. Now, if we wanted to record this signal and digitize it to bring it into a computer to perform analysis, this is going to be pretty tough unless we're particularly clever. If we just brute force sampled this signal, remember we would have to sample at something that's twice the highest frequency in the signal, and that's going to be 22 gigahertz. So there are analog to digital converters that run up that high, but they don't have a particularly fantastic bit depth, and they're complicated and expensive. And also there's a ton of hardware that needs to go in front of the analog digital converter, and that's all going to be tricky to make as well. The main observation is to note that there's nothing out here. The actual bandwidth of the signal is really just 2 gigahertz. So here's a trick we can use. So let me call this center frequency here omega c. So this is going to be 2 pi, because I want to do this in radians per second, times 10 times, I guess, 10 to the 9th radians per second. I guess you could write that as 10 to the 10th, but I don't think that's helpful here. Now, I'm thinking about the C here as standing for center and not as carrier. Carrier would imply that there was some intelligent life that was trying to create a communication scheme and put some information centered at a particular frequency that's the carrier. I don't want to necessarily make that implication. So let me actually scoosh this whole thing over to the right a little bit just so I have some space for what I'm about to do. All right, let's call the signal here x of t. And the name of the game is to take x of t. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this signal and we're going to multiply it by e to the minus j omega c t. And that's going to give us a new signal that I'm going to call x left of t. This is not standard notation. I made that up. If you remember from your Fourier transform property, if I were to take x of t and then multiply it by e to the minus j omega c t in the time domain, that corresponds to taking our waveform and shifting it, in this case, shifting it to the left by omega c in the frequency domain, hence my use of the word left here. All right, so what does that look like? So let me draw a new horizontal axis here. If Adobe Sketchbook has an actual line drawing function, I should probably learn how to use that. Anyway, so everything's getting shifted over by 10. So let me put down tick marks for minus 10 and minus 20 gigahertz. And now this function in pink here is going to be shifted over here like this. Don't have anything at minus 10, but what was at minus 10 is now going to land here, like thus. Doot, 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 doot. All right, so the extent here is going from minus 1 to 1. I guess this would be going from minus 21 to minus 19. And the important thing to note is all of the actual information is captured here in the signal that's sitting here with its frequency content at the origin. So all I need to do in the next stage is pass everything here through a low-pass filter that has a cutoff going from minus 1 to 1 gigahertz in this particular example. And let me call the output of that XBT. And the B here stands for baseband. It does not stand for baseband with two S's, which I guess would be a band with more than one bass player. Anyway, it's not that. Anyway, that filter is going to kill off the copy down here at minus 20 gigahertz, and I will be left with this spectrum here in the middle. So I can just draw that right here. I'll go from minus 1 to 1 gigahertz, and I just need to draw in my little triangle. Now, something should be a bit unsettling to you. Notice that this spectrum here, and for that matter, this spectrum here, is not conjugate symmetric. So that means that XB is not real valued. In fact, in general, X sub B is complex valued. And for that matter, what would it mean to actually multiply something by a complex number? This is a real valued signal coming in that's probably being represented as a voltage on a wire somewhere. How are we supposed to actually implement this crazy thing? Well, let's think for a second about what e to the minus j omega ct is. If I rewrite this with Euler's formula, I could write cosine omega ct minus j sine omega ct. And this works out because cosine is an even function and sine is an odd function. So when I plug the minus sign into cosine, it basically disappears. And when I plug the minus sign into the minus sign can be pulled out in front. So let me take x of t and split it into two parts. Now, in a real RF system, just making a box that takes your signal and splits it into two parts without having excessive loss or weird phase shifts in one branch that are not present in the other, that can actually turn out to be a bit tricky, but let's pretend we can do it magically. All right, so here I'm just going to take one of these copies of x of t, and we're going to multiply it with cosine omega ct. And then I'll take the other copy here, and we're going to multiply it with minus sine omega ct. And in most systems, these are still just voltages. I just happen to have two different voltages on two different wires. And it's up to me to think about this part up here as being the real part, and this part down here as being the imaginary part. It's up to us to keep track of that. So now I can build two copies of this filter that in this particular instance is filtering out things between minus 1 and 1 gigahertz. And these are now just standard real value filters. And again, you could take entire graduate classes on how to build analog filters that work at RF. And there's all sorts of different trade-offs involved with different technologies. That's by no means a trivial task. And then what do I have coming out here? Well, on this top branch, I'll have the real part of my baseband signal. And on this branch down here, I'll have the imaginary part of my baseband signal. And again, these are just voltages on wires. Our wires don't know anything about complex numbers or whatever. Anyway, now at this point, you can put in some analog to digital converters. And now these only need to be running at a rate appropriate for sampling a 1 gigahertz signal. And so I have this one here running at 2 gigahertz, and I can have this one running at 2 gigahertz. Now, whether it's before or after sampling, the real part of the signal is often referred to as the in-phase part of the baseband signal, and the imaginary part of the signal is often referred to as the quadrature part of the baseband signal. So this overall approach is sometimes referred to as an IQ representation. This general idea of creating a baseband version of a bandpass signal that's centered at some high frequency is useful in applications far different than radio astronomy. This or something similar to it is often the first stage of a receiver in a communication system, and this is also used to capture and analyze signals from things like the radar signals that might be sent out by an airplane.